Some viewers may find the following video disturbing. Viewer discretion is advised.
Hello everyone, my name is Don, the movie reviewer, and today we are going to be talking about the most disappointing movies of 2018. Now, ladies and gentlemen, this list just consists of movies that I thought were disappointing this year. There'll probably be a couple of movies that I mention in here that are garbage.
Ask yourself this. Would you believe a 15-year-old kid was working for the federal government?
But he was.
White Boy Rick. White Boy Rick is a movie that I saw the trailer for. I was looking forward to it. I took my nephew to go see it because I had tickets to an advanced screening. And when I saw the trailer, it intrigued me. You know, it's got Matthew McConaughey. He's a good actor. It's based on a true story. I like movies that are based on true stories. It looked like a crime, gritty drama. It looked good. I'm like, okay. And obviously, this looks like it's trying to go for an Academy Award. So I watched the movie, and it was boring. It was a very boring movie, and I did not care about anything that was happening. And Jennifer Jason Leigh, she's a phenomenal actor, and she seemed like she was sleepwalking in this. This was just a boring movie. I didn't care about anything that was happening, and I wasn't invested in the character stories. Quiet Place. Yes, A Quiet Place is the most disappointing movie of 2018 because it was just a gimmicky movie for me. I mean, I will commend John Krasinski for his phenomenal performance. I will praise everyone in here for their phenomenal performances. The directing in here from John Krasinski was fantastic. He is a very talented director, and much success to his career in the future. And this was a pretty solid horror movie, but I just couldn't look past all of these little gimmicks. Like, the thing is that there's these creatures out here, and it's revealed at the end of the movie, I'm not going to spoil it, but it's revealed at the end that something affects them, and it's just weird. It's like, it reminds me of It Comes at Night, but except these creatures come at night. Or during the day too, but it's like where It Comes at Night, the ending was depressing, whereas in this, the ending, I would say, is a satisfying ending for a person who was looking for a gimmicky horror movie. You know, if you really wanted a serious thriller drama, then this isn't it. This isn't it. I mean, at the beginning it seems like it is, but then by the very end and these little cliche things that happen in the middle, is disappointing. The ending just ruins the entire experience for me.
Audiences love happy endings.
Three mothers, three God, three devil. Mother Tenebrarum, Mother Lacrimarum, and Mother Suspiriorum.
Suspiria. 2018, directed by Luca Guadagnino. I did see his movie Call Me By Your Name. I thought that movie was pretty good. And so I was looking forward to this. I don't care for the original Suspiria movie, and I haven't seen the trilogy. I thought the original Suspiria movie was very boring. The narrative was just dull, but it did have beautiful colors in it, and the cinematography was great, and the music was great. And that's pretty much it. But I saw the trailer for Suspiria 2018. It looked good. And then so I decided to see it, paid my ticket, watched it. And it was very disappointing. It's too long, so it's boring. And Tilda Swinton's in here, and she plays multiple characters, and she plays this one character who's a man. And when I first saw the movie, I couldn't quite pinpoint what my problem was. I just had this weird feeling. And I knew it was Tilda Swinton. Maybe that ruined it for me. But then I did hear people telling me about, well, you know, you hear Tilda Swinton's voice as this man character, and it sounds like a woman. And so I was like, yeah, that's what I heard. That couldn't quite pinpoint it at the first time, but it made sense. And it's weird stuff happening in here, and I feel like Suspiria 2018 is just a shock value horror movie. You know, the narrative is semi-interesting. The only narrative I care about in this story, and there's multiple narratives going on here, and they're all boring, except for one I thought was fairly interesting, but it kind of disappointed me by the end, was the character that, the male character that Tilda Swinton was playing. That character, this psychiatrist or whoever, I liked their journey at the beginning, even though I was a little taken out of the movie with Tilda Swinton playing this character. But just with the character itself, the narrative with that character, I enjoyed it at the beginning, and then the progression, you know, is building and building and building, and there's a very suspenseful scene in this movie that's great, but the ending's ruined, and it's just over the top, and it's just a shock value movie, and I don't care, it's boring. And yeah, I'd say Suspiria is, it's an okay movie. Like, the directing is great, the cinematography is great, the dance choreography is great, the performances in here from everybody is great, even Tilda Swinton, who plays the male character. It's just like the sound of the character's voice, I don't look at it as a man, and I see Tilda Swinton and I can't get that out of my head, so then it just bothers me throughout the entire movie. But yeah, I it's gross if you're looking for some gross stuff, and that's it.
Would you do me a favor and eat my pussy for me, please?
La, 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 la. Come on!
Oh, shit.
This is my life. This isn't some game. La, 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 la,
la, la. American Animals. I saw the trailer for this based on a true story. It looked good. I watched it. And it's boring. It's a very boring movie. And I didn't care about the characters. I wasn't invested in their stories. I didn't relate to any of them, I guess, so it didn't hit me emotionally on any level. The directing's great, the performances are great, and that's all I got from it. I didn't really get anything from this movie. People want to say it's a different kind of heist movie, and I guess, you know, I don't know. I thought the heist in this movie, that scene was very intense. It was a very intense heist scene. You know, it was very intense, but by the end of the movie, I just didn't care. There's only one scene that I really enjoyed, and the directing was great, and the cinematography is great, all that stuff, performances, but that doesn't make a movie for me. The narrative is what draws me in, and the narrative in this, I thought, fucking sucked.
These creatures were here before us. And if we're not careful, they're gonna be here after.
Jurassic World Fallen Kingdom. Jurassic World Fallen Kingdom.
Right.
Yeah, it's Jurassic World Fallen Kingdom. That's all I need to say. This is a rebuquel, which means that it is a remake of The Lost World, Jurassic Park. But it's masquerading around as an original movie that is a sequel to the Jurassic World movie that was a remake of Jurassic Park. And it's just a cash grab. There's nothing original in this movie. It's the same shit as in The Lost World. It's like, this, whoever is the executive producers of this, the writers, whatever, whoever's in charge is like, how dare you just completely mimic the first Jurassic Park movie when you make Jurassic World? Then you have the audacity to make Jurassic World Fallen Kingdom and just completely make The Lost World all over again. You just did two for two. It's like, what, you make the new Jurassic Park movie, Jurassic World, whatever you want to call it, and this is going to be a remake of Jurassic 3. This is a terrible franchise. They need to just end this already. Jurassic Park's a classic, and the rest of the sequels, they suck. And just leave it alone, man. Just leave it alone. It's a pile of shit. Jurassic World Funkin' is garbage. They say it's a family movie, but like, I wouldn't let my kids watch this because, you know, people get eaten and stuff, you know? Like, no. Absolutely not.
Hey, Baxley, if your mom's vagina were a video game, it'd be rated E for everyone.
Isn't posing a threat.
The Predator by Shane Black. I was looking forward to this movie. Because Shane Black, you know, he wrote the script for the, he didn't write the script. I stand corrected. He was a star in the first Predator movie with Arnold Schwarzenegger. And I heard he had some hand with the script. Like he did something to it, I guess. I don't know. But he was in the first movie. And then, you know, we have the sequels and they're all garbage. And they don't hold a candle to the first one. So then we got Shane Black, a man who was in the original movie with Arnold Schwarzenegger in the 80s. He's coming to take the helm from this. And he shits all over it. I don't know what he was doing. I don't know what his problem was. I don't know how he came up with this. You know, I love Kiss Kiss Bang Bang. Iron Man 3 is okay. Well, Iron Man 3 is a pretty good movie. I don't know. But it's like, come on, man. The Predator, man. Question mark. So, yeah, The Predator, man. It's garbage, man. It's garbage. I can't say anything about this without spoiling things because it's garbage.
I mean, shit. Unbelievable. Unremarkable. Shit.
Don't you ever raise your voice at me! I am your mother!
Raise your hand!
Mom, what's happening?
Make it stop!
I just don't want to put any more stress on my family.
Fuck. Not even funny anymore.
Hereditary. Hereditary is a movie I saw the trailer for, and I was excited. And on top of that, the director of this, he directed a short film that you can watch here on YouTube called The Strange Thing About the Johnsons. And that is a really good short film. Check that out. And so I was excited to see this movie because of that. And so I watched the movie and it starts, and the directing along with the cinematography and the music and the performances in this movie, it's all fantastic. And the narrative is lazy and uninteresting because it's just generic. I don't care about the situations that the characters went through by the end of the movie, because by the end of the movie, it's just explained as these random occurrences that took place, and they wanted these group of people within this family wanted to resurrect something, and it's very confusing. And it's just a bunch of coincidences that happen in here where we see generic cliche horror events. And then by the very end, we get this really cliche explanation. And then it's like everything that I saw in here was interesting and well-crafted and perfectly executed. But then as I'm watching these scenes take place and I notice these little things in the narrative that don't really make any sense with anything, and I'm like, where is this going? And then you see the end of the movie and it's just like, what? That for that? What? That doesn't tie into what, because you're telling me that like all of these random things occur that were out of your control and you wanted this grand scheme to happen, but it's like, what were those things I saw earlier part of your plan, or were they just random occurrences, you know? So it's just a very sloppy narrative, and the directing and acting and music and cinematography cannot hide the fact that the narrative is sloppy for me. And yeah, the technical aspects, fantastic, but the narrative is really sloppy, and so it really irked me. And yeah, you know, it's okay movie, it's fine, but it could have been way better. Well, I'd say it's pretty good. It's a pretty good movie.
You know what your problem is, Don the Movie Reviewer? Is that you lack originality. You would never notice an original movie if it smacked you in your ugly face.
Now the best thing we have going for us is being who we are.
Why?
Because no one thinks we have the balls to pull this off.
Last night in the foothills of Santa Susana Pass, where a private plane crashed with no survivors. CBS 2 has obtained
Widows. Now, Widows. Holy crap. Widows, man. Gillian Flynn. Fantastic novelist. She made one of my favorite books, Gone Girl. I did read that. It was a great book. And I also read Sharp Objects. That is a phenomenal book. Lots of mystery suspense in there. And then she wrote the screenplay for David Fincher's Gone Girl, which was one of my favorite movies the year it came out. And it still is one of my favorite. I love that movie. And so we got Gillian Flynn in here, who I love. And then we have Steve McQueen, who made 12 Years a Slave. It was a great movie. Love that movie the year it came out. And so we got a powerhouse in screenwriter and director. I'm like, boom, that's all you need to make a perfect movie. And the cast, holy crap, the cast is absolutely stacked in this movie. We got Liam Neeson, Viola Davis, Michelle Rodriguez. We got Robert Duvall, Colin Farrell, Daniel Kaluuya, who's an up-and-coming star. And it's a stack. The deck is stacked. How can this movie fail? And I saw the trailer, and I was just like, you know, it reminds me of 999. And then so I watched the movie, went to an advanced screening, and it was very disappointing. This movie doesn't suck by any means. It's not garbage because of directing. The directing in here by Steve McQueen is phenomenal. The acting all across the board is exceptional. The only thing that I can say negative about this is the narrative. The story in here is sloppy. It's all over the place. It can't concentrate on one thing, and it tries to cram all this crap down your throat about, I don't want to give it away, but about a certain subject matter. And then there's this heist in the background, which just like this one scene where they tried to, where they scope out Colin Farrell's mansion. It felt like I was watching Mission Impossible, the third one, the third Mission Impossible. It felt like I was watching that. So I'm like, this is some generic stuff. And so by the very end, like I was invested like from the beginning to the midpoint. I would say probably about an hour or so into it, it loses me. And then by the very end of the movie, the ending is terrible. And therefore, it just ruins the rest of the experience for me. So now I'm left with this sour taste in my mouth. It's like you're chewing on this phenomenal piece of gum and you're chewing it and you're like, this tastes so good. And then after like, I don't know, 5 minutes of chewing it, you're like, okay, yeah, the flavor's gone. This tastes horrible. And then, you know, you spit it out because you're just like, oh, it started good and it ended poorly. And that's how I feel about Widows. I say Widows is an okay movie. The directing's great, acting's great, but the narrative, meh.
You don't believe in the boogeyman?
He's here!
Michael!
Halloween 2018, I am a junkie Michael Myers fan. I'm a junkie. I'm an addict for Michael Myers, even though he has a very shitty franchise. And the first John Carpenter Halloween is a classic movie. I watched it not too long ago, and it blew me away. I didn't even want to watch that movie. Yeah, you know, it has some problems in there, but the cinematography is great. The directing is great. I'm praising the original Halloween. I have to, man. Because David Gordon Green's Halloween doesn't hold a candle to John Carpenter's original classic. The only phenomenal thing in David Gordon Green's Halloween is the freaking soundtrack. You're turning Michael Myers into a superhero, and that's not cool, man. He's a psychopathic murderer who I'm supposed to be afraid of, and he's supposed to be lurking in the shadows, and I'm supposed to be looking at the screen trying to be like, where is Waldo? But it's, where is Michael? He could be anywhere. And with these new movies, especially Halloween 2018, they missed the mark completely. They put Michael in the forefront, and they try, in the bathroom scene, there's this rock music playing, and it's like, am I supposed to feel terrified? Am I supposed to feel like, yeah, Michael, kill the bitch? And it's like, what? I'm supposed to be scared, not rooting for Michael, okay? And David Gordon Green, you know, is the Halloween. This movie is okay.
So, how is he?
Oh, you know, same old Ethan.
Oh,
Mission Impossible Fallout. I love slash hate this movie. I love the first Mission Impossible by Brian De Palma. It's a cheesy movie, but it's got some great performances and some lots of surprises. And the directing makes it perfect. And the sequels, they all suck. Except when we had Brad Bird come in here and make Mission Impossible Ghost Protocol, which is phenomenal, exciting. And then we have Christopher McQuarrie, who made the Mission Impossible Rogue Nation movie, which is hard hitting and intense. And it's silly. It's silly stuff, you know, lots of over the top antics in here, but it's thrilling, you know, it gets your adrenaline pumping. If you're an action junkie, you will love those two movies, especially Rogue Nation. Very hard hitting. And then we have Christopher McQuarrie, who returns for Mission Impossible Fallout. And Mission Impossible Fallout is even more hard-hitting than Rogue Nation. The fight choreography in this movie is phenomenal. The acting all across the board is exceptional. We have, you could argue that this is one of the best Mission Impossible movies, just because of the scope of this movie, the cinematography, the directing, the twists and turns, you know? I don't think it's nowhere near as good as the first one, but it has essence of the first movie in there, along with your modern day action movie with some intelligence. And all those aspects are great. But where Mission Impossible fails for me, and why it's my most disappointing movie of 2018, is the fact that there's so many twists and turns in here. It stretches the plot so thin that by the very end, once everything is revealed, I get a headache and I say, what was the point of all of that shit? It's good, but then it's not good, because it makes me feel like the characters I was just introduced to were wasted, okay? And it just really upset me. I love slash hate this movie. It's a good movie. I would say Mission Impossible Fallout is a good movie, but at the same time, it's disappointing, because I was like having fun with the movie, but at the same time, I was frustrated. I was like, yeah, dumb fun action movie. Turn your brain off and watch it. But at the same time, it makes you use your brain to try and figure things out. But I feel like if you're too zeroed in on it, you're going to feel upset, because you're like, wait, that doesn't make any sense now that you reveal that. And this doesn't make any sense. What, you know, it's like all over the place. It's good, but then it's bad at the same time. It's a good movie. It's one of the best action movies of the year. But at the same time, it is one of the most disappointing movies of the year. And that's number one. And that is my list. And so, hope you enjoyed it, and thank you for watching. Now, if you want to get spoiled, let's get into it. All right, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for sticking around this long, because now we are going to get into spoiler territory. But before we get into it, I'm just going to pre-warn you that I do not want to take the time to edit any video for what I'm about to say concerning these movies. So if you just want to hear me talk about them, feel free to listen. And if you don't, then don't watch. But enjoy. A Quiet Place is a movie. When I saw the initial trailer for it, I was intrigued. I went to the theater, I watched the movie, and by the very end, I was disappointed. And here's why. The beginning of this movie is amazing. It sets the tone for what I think is going to be for the entire runtime. But then as it progresses, the somber moments turn into gimmicky cliche moments. And then by the very end, it just feels like the entirety of the movie was wasted so they could just make a sequel. So I was disappointed. And when I think about it, A Quiet Place reminds me of another movie called It Comes at Night. Whereas in It Comes at Night, it's a somber movie, it's depressing, and it has a sad ending. And in A Quiet Place, it's a similar premise. You know, it's the end of the world, we're following a family, we're watching them go through their trials and tribulations. And the only difference is that we actually see creatures in here. And the creatures are gimmicky. You know, they are blind and they can only attack when you make a noise. And at the very beginning of the movie, it doesn't feel that way, because they go there. They go to a dark place where they kill the kid at the very beginning. And then so you're witnessing this family go through their trials and tribulations, and they're about to, the mother's about to give birth to another child. And at the same time, the daughter is having some emotional problems with her father, and we learn that she is deaf. So I feel like the movie perfectly illustrates her condition in the narrative. And so there are good moments in the movie as I'm watching it, and then there are a couple of moments that just feel cheesy, and they're just using the gimmick because, I mean, what else can you do here? And by the very end of the movie, it ruins everything. The ending turns this movie into, I don't even know what you would call it, but the ending to this movie is horrible, and it just tarnishes the rest of the movie. Because, yeah, I don't need a depressing ending like And It Comes at Night in order for this movie to be good, but when I see that ending, I mean, yeah, it's ambiguous. It's like you can come up with your own interpretation. You can say that the family got killed by the creatures because there's so many of them, or you can say she used her shotgun and fought them all off. The choice is yours. But the ending, to me, it just kind of ruins the rest of the experience, because then I'm like, well, why the hell do they even want to live in this apocalyptic world? What the hell are they doing? What the hell can a sequel even be? This is going to turn into some Walking Dead kind of garbage where, you know, the first few seasons are very intriguing, and then it keeps going on and on, and to the point where you're not invested anymore because it's just the same shit. And so I enjoyed A Quiet Place up until the end, and the ending tarnished the rest of the movie for me. And so I believe A Quiet Place, it doesn't suck. It's a good movie, but it's highly disappointing. Suspiria, 2018. Suspiria 2018 is a movie that I was looking forward to because of the director, Luca Guadagnino. I did like his movie, Call Me By Your Name. I thought that was very good. I didn't love it like everybody, but I thought it was good. And so I was intrigued that he was doing this. I saw the original Suspiria movie. I didn't see the trilogy. I just saw the Suspiria movie, the original one. And I didn't like it all that much. It's just a gore fest to me. And it's, you know, it's very colorful. That's why I was like, I don't know why they didn't bring in Nicholas Winding Refn to direct Suspiria 2018. But whatever. So I saw the trailers for Suspiria 2018. They looked really good. I was intrigued. I went to the theater. And by the end, I was disappointed. And here's why. Because to me, Suspiria 2018 just feels like a shock value movie. There's a lot of swearing in here. You know, there's lots of blood and disturbing images. And that's all it is. To me, that there's no, the plot is meaningless. The narrative is just sloppy and it goes on forever. And there are a few moments in this movie that are great. There are some moments in this movie that are fantastic. Like I will say, the moments that stick out to me is the scene where the woman is being like contorted, her body is just being like contorted, and it's really gross. It's a good sequence. Then all the dance numbers in here, you know, the dance choreography is fantastic. So I love those little moments with the people who are dancing, and I love the final dance in this movie. I thought that was really well done. It was very suspenseful. But I don't want to sit through a 2-hour movie just to get 5 or 10 minutes of awesome scenes. I don't want to do that. Okay. So this movie it's, I don't like it. I don't care for it. You know, even though it does have some good moments in here, I don't care for this movie. It's, to me, it just feels like a shock value film to where it's like, oh, there's a penis. Oh, this woman said cunt. Oh, heads are exploding. Oh, there's blood and gore. Oh, here's this freaking looking witch. Oh, she's got hands sticking out of her arms. Oh, God, it's so gross and disturbing. And it's like, that's all the movie has going for it. The narrative to me is really sloppy. I don't care about these people. I don't really even understand what's going on. There's so much going on in this movie that I can't follow it. And yes, someone did explain it to me, but I still don't care about this movie. And to me, Suspiria 2018 was super disappointing. It could have been so much more than a shock value film. And that's what I think this is. It's just a shock value horror movie. And it's got some great dance choreography in here. The directing's good. The music is good. The acting is good. All that stuff is great. It's just the narrative is lazy and it's sloppy. And it's just a shock value horror movie. And I don't like it. Widows. Widows is a movie that I was looking forward to. I was anticipating this movie so much. Because it's stacked to the brim. It's got a great screenwriter, Gillian Flynn, who I read two of her books. I read Sharp Objects, which is great. I've read Gone Girl, which is great. And then she even wrote the screenplay for Gone Girl. And I thought the screenplay within Gone Girl was flawless. We have David Fincher, who directed that, which was great. And then we have Steve McQueen, who made 12 Years a Slave. I've seen some other movies in his resume, which I'm like, they're fine, but I really love 12 Years a Slave. It's my favorite movie. And he's directing this. So we have a great screenwriter in Gillian Flynn. We have a great director in Steve McQueen. How can this movie fail? We also have a stacked cast in here. We have Liam Neeson, Viola Davis. We've got Daniel Kaluuya, who's on the up and coming right now. We've got all of these great pieces of talent in here. This movie is guaranteed to win. So I guess my expectations were too high. They were through the roof. So I saw this movie and I just was disappointed because to me, it seems like this movie has two different narratives. You have one narrative where, you know, these women need money and they have to perform this heist. Then you have another narrative that deals with classism. It deals with race. And I feel like the race part of this narrative is very sloppily handled. It's sloppily executed because they try to build this mystery in here where at the beginning, you know, it just seems like, oh, you got a couple and they're in love with each other. And it's very intense loving, like they're damn near about to shove each other's tongue down each other's throats. And I felt it. And then it intercuts between Liam Neeson performing this heist. So then when he dies, I'm like, okay, cool. This is interesting. And then we got Michelle Rodriguez in here and Elizabeth Debicki. And then they're both women who are down on their luck and they need money. And then Viola Davis is being threatened by Brian Tyree Henry, who is a man who's running for the mayor's office. And he's going up against Colin Farrell. And Colin Farrell has a problem with his dad, played by Robert Duvall, who's great in this movie. And then so there's all these different elements in here. Like you got these political elements dealing with racism. And I don't really feel like it hits racism on the nose. I feel like it's just kind of there being like, here it is. It's just presenting it. It's not really, it's addressing the issues, but it's not really, it's not doing anything about it. Like, I'm not saying like it should do, like it should be like a really strong message or anything. I just feel like it's there just because. So then so once you really understand what's going on in this movie, like there's a scene later on where you see the son get shot by a white police officer. And that doesn't happen until later on in the movie. And when I saw that scene, I kind of rolled my eyes because it's like, this movie's about to end and you're going to show this to me. Why were you even hiding this from me at the beginning? Because there are flashbacks in this movie where we see Liam Neeson and Viola Davis and they're laying in bed and she's crying about something. And then she's like, fucking me won't make it better. And then she says something about her skin color. Like, yeah, if you hadn't had a son with me or something or a kid with me, maybe he'd still be alive. So she's issuing the fact that, yeah, I'm black. And that's the reason why he got killed. And to me, it just kind of feels like it's just thrown in there. Right? Because they build this mystery of like, well, why is she so sad? Why did they have a falling out in their marriage? And then we learn that the son got shot. And then so then it comes out of nowhere to me. Right? And then at the very end, you got Liam Neeson showing up talking about, I had to save me. And it's like, he's very selfish. So then that just tarnishes everything that we saw between these two at the beginning of the movie, which I guess is the point, because you see their romance and you're like, oh, that's pretty nice. And then it's like, you see how selfish he is and it tarnishes the whole thing. But it's like, what was the point of, like, so why did he kill his team at the beginning? Like, and it was completely obvious that he wasn't dead. Like, I've noticed in movies when you don't see the character die, obviously they're going to come back. Like, as soon as I saw that explosion, I was like, of course he's going to come back at the end. And I was right. So that ruined it for me right there. And then, you know, it's like, why did he, she's like, oh, you're going to go to your white family. And I just feel like they're really shoving the race thing down your throat. The only scene that I felt in this movie that kind of perfectly illustrated the whole race thing is when we see Colin Farrell giving a speech. He gets in his car and it's just one tracking shot of the car on his hood. And we go from the poor neighborhood to the rich neighborhood. And I thought that that shot was phenomenal. That's the best scene in the whole movie. And other than that, I don't really get the whole race thing in here. I feel like it's just shoved down our throat and it's forced and it doesn't address anything. It's just there, you know, as the backdrop to the grand scheme of things, whereas these women who just need money need to perform this heist. And a lot of people want to say, well, you got Michelle Rodriguez in here, and it's kind of like a switch flip where she's usually a badass female character, and in here, you know, she's down on her luck and she needs money. Hear me out. I don't care who she is as an actor. I don't care that she's Michelle Rodriguez. I care about the character. When I watch a movie, I'm not watching it just to see a performance from this actor. I want to see who this character is. I want to know the ethos and pathos of this character. I want to feel them. I want to understand them. I want to walk out of the movie with the character, not the actor. Well, yeah, their acting performance, of course, leaving a lasting impression on me. But I really want to go out and be like, you know what? That was a really good character. It was very compelling. And it was interesting. And it accessed my train of thought. Whereas in this, it's just like, oh, Michelle Rodriguez is usually a badass. We're going to throw her in here. And yeah, you know, she's going to be down on her luck. She's going to play a character she's never played before. And it's like, I don't care about that. That's just a gimmick, man. I'm not watching this movie for a gimmick. I'm watching to be invested in a deeply affecting story. And the movie just pissed me off more so than anything else. Because, yeah, at the very end, we got Liam Neeson showing up, confronting Viola Davis, and this is a really gimmicky camera trick that I don't like. And this really pisses me off in the movie where you see the scene where Liam Neeson walks up to Viola Davis at the end. He throws her on the ground. He pulls out a gun and you think, oh, he's about to shoot her. So then he turns around, he points the gun at her and the camera focuses on him. You hear a gunshot, but you don't see who necessarily got shot. So it's an editing camera trick. It's trying to get emotion out of the audience by using editing and a camera trick. And to me, that just doesn't work. I want to feel suspense in a movie and tension through narrative, through character development, through character interaction. This scene here is just trying to cheat to get that suspenseful emotion out of me by using this cheap, gimmicky editing camera trick. By saying, oh yeah, Liam Neeson shot Viola Davis at the very end of the movie. Give me a freaking break. This movie's not going to go and turn the left field like that when it's almost over, right? So then they do this thing where you think he shoots her. And a lot of people gasped in my theater. And I was just like, come on, man, don't you dare do this. And then so the gimmicky thing is that, okay, we think that she got shot and then like Liam Neeson falls out of frame and then Viola Davis comes back in frame and we learn that she's had a gun in her hand and she shot him. That is the most gimmicky thing that a director can do. Steve McQueen, you could do so much better than that. Like, I hate that moment in the movie so freaking much that it just tarnishes the rest of the movie for me because the ending to this movie is absolutely atrocious. It is a horrible ending. And it's like, to me, the movie doesn't start to fall apart until close to the second act leading into the ending. It starts to fall apart because I don't care about Michelle Rodriguez. And Elizabeth Debicki gets a lot of development because we see her, you know, she gets a lot of things from her husband and her husband dies. And then she goes and joins the escort service and she meets this guy and she gives the speech about I can ruin my own life. So we get development with her, which is great. But Michelle Rodriguez gets put on the back burner. Viola Davis is in here, she's a phenomenal actor. And, you know, Robert Duvall in here is great. Daniel Kaluuya in here is great. The directing is great. You know, the cinematography is great. But the narrative is so all over the place. And they shove the racism thing down your throat to the point of when you see the end of this movie, it just feels way over the top to me. And then he uses this gimmicky camera trick to try and get an emotion out of me instead of just using the narrative on itself. So when we have the reunion between Liam Neeson and Viola Davis at the end, I don't care. It doesn't matter to me. I'm just like in this movie already. And then they do the stupid camera trick. And I'm just like, okay, fuck this movie, man. You know, I don't care. You know, it tries to address these issues when really it kind of, to me, just shoves them in here to try to tell some sort of story between classism. But it doesn't really get its point across, I don't think, you know, because of this whole heist thing, which is just gimmicky and cliche. You know, like when this black chick with blonde hair comes in here, she just decides to help them for no reason. Because she needs money, I guess. We don't see her like struggling or anything like that. I mean, yeah, she runs to the bus. I don't like the way the movie ends. And I don't like the racism narrative in here because it just feels sloppily handled and executed. Halloween 2018 is a movie that I was looking forward to. I did put it in my top 10 most anticipated movies of 2018 because I am a Halloween Michael Myers junkie, even though I think the franchise is shitty. I was looking forward to it. I saw the trailer and I was intrigued and I was happy that John Carpenter was coming back because, you know, John Carpenter has always been very vocal about not returning to this franchise because it's shitty. They just want to make money off of this. And to me, the only thing that exists in the Halloween franchise is John Carpenter's original classic. Like, all the sequels to me are garbage, and so they don't exist to me. The one and only is John Carpenter's Halloween, and that's it. And the Rob Zombie movies, I know as much hate as those movies get, I appreciate what Rob Zombie was trying to do. And so those Rob Zombie movies live in a different dimension, and I like those movies, but they're not like connected to John Carpenter's. So I will say that I do like John Carpenter's Halloween. All of the sequels within that universe suck. And then the stuff that Rob Zombie made is its own thing. And Halloween 2018 is a sequel to the original. And it's one of the best sequels in the franchise, but then that's still not saying much because the franchise is just shitty to begin with, except for the first movie. And with this, I remember when I first saw it, the opening scene, when I first saw it, I was like, this is intense. And then I watched it again. I've seen the movie multiple times. And I watched it again. That opening scene is just ridiculous. It's extremely over the top. And then the credits opening credits are bad too. It's just a CGI pumpkin, you know? It's bad. And then I'd say the worst thing in this movie is what every Halloween movie does this, and they get it wrong every single time, is when they have to show Michael Myers in full frame. They have to show his face. They have to show his jumpsuit. They have to show everything. And that is a very annoying thing to me. Because when you watch John Carpenter's original classic, you do not see his face until like pretty close to the very end of the movie where he's in full frame when he picks up the telephone. But everything before that, it's either in shadow, he's cast in shadow, or it's from afar, right? We don't really get a clear profile of his face close up until the moment where he picks up the phone. And then after that, we see his face clear as day. But everything before that, it's always in shadow, right? And I understand why John Carpenter called him the Shape, the boogeyman in the original movie, because he's a force of nature, right? He's a guy who is not a guy. He's not a man. He's the boogeyman. He's the force of nature. You know, he's just this shape that reappears and disappears. And so when he pops out and strangles Bob and hangs him up by one arm and then pins him to the wall with the butcher knife, I let it go because he's an entity. He's a force, you know? Like, yeah, we see him as a boy at the beginning, but then at the end, you know, when he's an adult, it's like what happened between that time period, you know? And that's why I love the original Halloween, is just so he's shrouded in mystery, right? Whereas in Halloween 2018, they humanize him. Whereas, yeah, you can say in John Carpenter's movie he was humanized, but he's doing all of these supernatural things to where it's like a normal man can't do that, right? So when he disappears at the end, I accept it. I'm like, yeah, this guy is mysterious. And that's what I like about Michael, is the mysterious nature about him and how we don't really get to see him fully in the movie. We see him in shadows and he takes his time to kill his victims and all this stuff. Whereas in Halloween 2018, it does the same thing as all the other Halloween sequels. We see Michael Myers in full frame and he's walking around and he's killing people, and it's just not scary. It's not suspenseful. I feel like the only reason this movie was even a little bit scary was because of John Carpenter's music. Like, the music in this movie is phenomenal. That, I think that's the only really redeeming quality about this movie. I mean, Michael Myers looks cool in here. Like, I like the mask, but it just looks like Rob Zombie, which is nothing wrong with that. But, he looks cool. But they really just misused Michael in here, just like every other sequel, man. It's like, if you were really trying to recapture the magic of the first movie, you failed. It's like, you can't capture lightning in a bottle twice. Everyone tries to do it, but the bottle just sinks down to the ocean floor and it doesn't get any lightning in it because they can't redo it. They just can't. Just leave it alone. Just leave Halloween alone. Just let this die. Because with Halloween 2018, like I said, my favorite sequence in here is the sequence where, you know, he goes into Henfield for the first time. He bumps into that kid, which is reminiscent of Halloween 2, John Carpenter's Halloween 2. And then, you know, Michael walks into the garage. He grabs the hammer. He goes in the house and he kills that lady off screen. And that's a very horrifying scene because we don't witness the killing, right? We just see the chair fall down and it's perfectly executed. And then we see Michael go outside and he goes to a new house and he looks through the window and he walks around to the back and he sneaks up behind her. And the conclusion to this whole thing is lazy. He just stabs her in the back of the neck and then he walks away. And it's like, that's it? That's not scary. That's lazy. It feels like you built all this up, but you just didn't know how to end it. You know, it's like, if it was me and I was directing this movie, this is how I would have done it. I would have made this absolutely terrifying. I would have been like, okay. So he walks to the house. He looks in the window. He walks around to the back. He walks up behind the lady, smashes her face into the window or something. Her nose starts bleeding. And then he pulls her and drags her back, throws her onto the sofa that is behind them. She puts her hands up in self-defense. And then he stabs her with a knife through the hand. And then he's stabbing her in the face and in the chest. And you hear her screaming. And at that point, you're seeing the killing from a distance, right? But you don't see like any blood or gore or anything like that. And that's the problem with this movie too. It just, it does what all of the fucking sequels did. It goes for the blood and the gore. And it's like, that's not what John Carpenter's classic was about. We barely see any blood and gore in that movie, you know? And yeah, you can say it's due to the budget restraint, which is fine. They had to work with what they had. But in this movie, 2018, it's like, okay, he stabs her in the neck and it's a gory scene and then that's it. And it's just like, that's it. Like, you built this so perfectly and then you conclude it so in a lazy manner to me, you know, where you could have built this suspense and tension. It's supposed to be scary. And then on top of that, they try to turn Michael Myers into like a superhero to where we're supposed to root for him or something. I'm like, no, I'm not supposed to root for him. I'm supposed to be terrified by him. Right. And then also in this movie, you know, Laurie Strode goes to the dinner table and she's like the shape. And it's like, OK, you're trying to force me to believe that Michael Myers is the shape in this movie. No, he's not. He don't feel like the shape to me. He feels like a normal guy just walking around killing people. This doesn't feel like Halloween to me. This just feels like those other sequels that are just about a guy in a mask who runs around and stalks his victims and kills them. Right? This has no essence of the original Halloween in it at all. Right? Because it's really bad. Like, you got these really well-executed scenes that just end poorly. And on top of that, I know people want to say, well, I feel like there are two camps to this movie. There are people who are saying that, okay, you know, Michael wanted to go after Laurie Strode because she's the one that got away. And then there are people who are saying, well, you know, Dr. Sartine actually brought Laurie Strode or brought Michael Dr. Sartine is the one who brought Michael to Laurie Strode. And I'm on that. I'm in that camp. I'm in camp B, because when I watch the movie, it doesn't seem like Michael gives a shit about Laurie. It's just the fact that he escapes. He gets his mask back. He kills the people because they have his mask. And then he just goes back into Henfield and he creates havoc. And that's it. He's not concerned about Laurie Strode. Laurie Strode's more concerned about him than he is about her, you know? And so it's not the only reason Michael even gets to Laurie Strode is because Dr. Sartine, who's used as a plot tool, is in there, and he's the reason why Michael escapes, and he's the reason why Michael and Laurie have their fight at the end. You know, he's just used as a plot device. And so then when Michael kills Dr. Sartine, you know, he steps on his head and his head explodes. And I don't like crap like that in the Halloween movie, man. Like, I can respect Rob Zombie for at least making something that where the kills felt realistic. Okay, I give him points for that. Because when I saw Michael Myers stomping someone's head out in Rob Zombie's Halloween 2, it looked real. And it looked brutal and painful. Whereas in Halloween 2018, it looked cheesy and goofy. It's silly as hell. He just stomps on his head one time and it explodes like a melon. And it's just like, that looks so silly to me. And then the ending with the traps and all this, and then like they don't shoot him, and then they try and burn him, but they don't witness him burn, and then we don't see him burn as an audience, and then he escapes and he's gone. Okay, we don't see his body. Of course he's not dead. They're gonna make a sequel to this, and it's just horrible. It's horrible. The movie doesn't suck. I think it's okay, but there are so many problems with this that it doesn't even come close to the essence of the original movie. And I was disappointed. I was very disappointed with this movie. Like, they seriously need to just watch Halloween a million freaking times to understand what Michael Myers is, what John Carpenter did to make that movie feel so special. It's just not about the kills. The kills don't make it feel important. It's the atmosphere. It's the tone. It's the way they portray Michael in the movie. He's just not some random guy. I mean, yeah, he is a random guy walking around killing people, but it's the way John Carpenter films him. You know, he's stalking people and stuff, hiding behind trees, hiding in bushes, hiding in the shadows. You don't really get to see his face until the end of the movie, really, you know? And Halloween 2018 dropped the ball. Mission Impossible Fallout. Mission Impossible Fallout is one of those movies that I have a love-hate relationship with. I feel that this movie is flawless, but it's also the narrative, I think, is bad. Because, yeah, the directing is great. The choreography is great. You know, the cinematography is great. There are lots of twists and turns in here that, you know, keep your mind working, because it's not one of those turn your brain off kind of action movies. It's one of those where you have to really pay attention to it, because if you walk away and you come back while it's still playing, you'll miss something, which is important. So it's good on that aspect, but I feel like the narrative, there's so many twists and turns, and it's too much for its own good, to where it really stretches the plot, and it stretches it so thin. It stretches the plot so thin, where at the beginning, I'm into it. It's one of those movies, again, where it's like at the beginning, I'm into it. And then when they do the big reveal at the end, it's just like, oh, really? It just ruins everything I seen prior to this, you know, where it's like, you know, you got the beginning. And they say this movie's complicated, when really it's a simple movie. It's you got the apostles who have formed their new group. From Rogue Nation. They were called the Syndicate. Now they're called the Apostles. Solomon Lane is, you know, incarcerated, and there's this guy named John Lark who wants to get some nuclear weapons so he can just blow up some stuff to create a new world order. And the Apostles have acquired plutonium, or they want to acquire plutonium. And Ethan Hunt intercepts the Apostles' deal with the Russians to get the plutonium. And then the Apostles steal the plutonium from him, but they need a nuclear weapon in order to use the plutonium. And then John Lark has that weapon. And then so we meet Walker, who is actually John Lark. And if you didn't know that just by watching the trailer, well, then good for you. But as soon as you see Henry Cavill character in here, you know immediately that he's the villain, so that's kind of ruined, which I think the movie already kind of illustrates him as the villain, I guess, but it gives it away. And we see Walker come in, and I think one of the most gimmicky scenes in this movie is the halo jump, where at the beginning, before I know the twists and turns, the halo jump is a good scene. You got, you know, they jump into the storm against Ethan Hunt's wishes, and then Walker or Lark gets struck by lightning, and then in this very intense moment, which is good, Ethan Hunt has to save Walker, and then they land on their target, and Walker or Lark, you know, says a joke, and it causes Ethan Hunt to roll his eyes. And I rolled my eyes at that moment too, because that scene is useless. It does nothing for the rest of the narrative. Like, to me, it's the same thing as all these other movies I talked about. The setup to it is perfect, right? Where they're like, we need to get to London to meet the White Widow within X amount of time. We got 2 hours to get there, so that's why we're doing this. Oh, there's a storm. We don't want to do that. But then Walker jumps into the storm for reasons for that. Yeah, he is Lark. He needs to get to this meeting, you know, because if he doesn't get to the meeting, then he's not going to be able to get the plutonium that he wants, right? So that's why Walker jumped into the storm, because he needs to get to this meeting. And I will give this movie points for using facial expression, because when I watch the movie again, I've seen this movie a dozen times. When I watch the movie again, there is a scene where Walker and Sloane are walking in at the beginning, and then Walker looks at his watch, and you see this expression on his face like, oh yeah, we're making good time right now. So I like those little things in here. And then when he jumps off the plane, at first you're like, why did he do that? But then when you learn that he's actually Lark, it's like, oh, he did that because he needs to get to this meeting, right? But then he's just a stupid freaking character, because then he gets struck by lightning. So then him getting to the meeting just happens by chance, right? Because the thing that baffles me is that, okay, he gets struck by lightning. He's unconscious. Hunt miraculously saves his life. Now, if Hunt hadn't saved his life, Walker would have completely missed that meeting for his stupidity. So that's a point against the movie right there. It's just by chance. And then, you know, I can let stuff like that go, but when the movie just keeps doing it, which this movie does, it just becomes annoying to me and it distracts me from the narrative. So then it's like he's unconscious, and then Hunt saves his life, Hunt lands on the target, and then all of a sudden Walker is awake, and then he lands on the target and cracks a joke about some oxygen. And it's just like, you built all this up just to have that stupid joke. Like, if it was me and I was directing this movie, I would have made that scene more meaningful. Like, yeah, you have the lightning strike, Hunt saves Walker's life, Hunt lands on his target, and then when he looks up and he sees Walker's parachute is, you know, extended, but Walker is still asleep. Walker is still unconscious. So then we see Walker just glide around and miss the target. So then if I would have saw that on screen, I would have been like, holy crap, now what are they going to do? Now Ethan Hunt has to go on this mission by himself because Walker fucked up and he's unconscious and he missed the target. You know, he's still unconscious. That's what I would have done. That would have built more suspense in the movie, right? Instead of just doing something like, oh, it looks cool, and then that's it. That's all it feels like. It's like, oh, it looks cool, and that's it, right? Where it's like, for example, Rogue Nation. Rogue Nation's underwater sequence is fantastic. It has consequences. It's like he's practicing. He goes down there. He fails. And then Elsa saves his life. And it makes sense that Elsa saved his life is because she was the one who was practicing to go down there until Ethan Hunt took over, right? So I like that scene. Whereas in this, it's just a cool sequence that means nothing and it goes nowhere and it has a cheesy ending. You know, there are no consequences. Yeah, you get struck by lightning, it's a consequence, but then all of a sudden you wake up and the mission just goes right on schedule. I hate that. I really hate that. And then, you know, the bathroom fight is great, but then this is Fast and Furious level shit right here. And if you don't think it is, then I don't know what to tell you, but this is Fast and Furious level shit right here. And the only reason it looks good is because it does look good. It is good. The fight choreography is amazing. The directing is amazing. The acting is amazing. But this is Fast and Furious level shit right here. You know, like you got this guy pulling pipes out of the wall. That will be in a Fast and Furious movie. You got a guy pulling a pipe out of the wall, you know, And then the movie goes on and we meet this character named the White Widow, which she is absolutely useless in here because she is working with the apostles to give Lark the plutonium. And so there's a scene in here where they're about to extract Solomon Lane. And during this scene, they play Dark Knight music, which it sounds like Dark Knight music mixed with, you know, a little bit of Mission Impossible theme in there, which is not a big deal. But then the sequence is executed like the scene in The Dark Knight, where, okay, you got Ethan Hunt, who is working with the White Widow to extract Solomon Lane in exchange for the plutonium. And you have the White Widow's brother saying, well, we're going to kill all the cops in order to get the plutonium. And when we learn later that the White Widow's actually working with the CIA, it makes me think about that extraction scene in their original plan of, like, they were going to kill all the cops. So if you're already working with the CIA and the CIA actually want them to extract Solomon Lane, do the CIA know that they're going to kill a bunch of innocent police officers? And if they do know that, well, then holy shit, I guess they're going to get Solomon Lane at no cost. But it's really just baffling to me that they're just going to let innocent people die, you know? So there's a little plot hole right there. And then on top of that, the White Widow is stupid because there's a scene where, you know, Tom Cruise executes his own plan and goes against her brother. And then Tom Cruise, as he's escaping, all of the White Widow's henchmen in the back of the truck fall out and they get arrested by the police. And then four of her men get killed by Tom Cruise. So then when she's confronting him about, like, why did you change the plan? And he's saying something like, yeah, it would have been bad from the word go. And I don't trust your brother. And we don't know why the White Widow doesn't trust her brother. Why does she trust this mysterious man over her brother? We really don't know. There's no real dynamic between these two. But she believes him. He's like, you would have lost half your men and all this stuff in the firefight. When really I would have believed her brother over this guy because if I was White Widow, I would have said, okay, so you're telling me that your plan was better than my brother's when you got a majority of my men arrested, the men that were in your truck, they're arrested and four of my men are dead. So whose plan was really better here? You know, and so it just shows her as a really stupid female character. She's just really dumb, you know, and she falls for this guy. I think she's just in love with him. So that's why she believes everything that he says. I don't even know why she's so head over heels about him. It makes no sense. It doesn't do anything for the story. And then, you know, at the very end, they do the twist where they reveal that she's working for the CIA. So then that's when I'm like, okay, they were going to kill all the cops and the CIA is just going to let that happen. So then it's just revealed that all that crap with the White Widow that we saw earlier in the movie is pointless and it means nothing. It built to nothing and she's a meaningless character. Okay, then they reveal that Walker's actually John Lark, which we already knew that. And then, you know, it's sloppy. Like, the narrative just stretches itself so thin that by the very end that I just roll my eyes to all these twists and turns because they're so unnecessary, right? Like, there's another scene in here that really upsets me, you know? Like, it just keeps piling on. Like, if it does it a few times, it's fine. I'll let it go. Like, for example, you see the scene in Dark Knight where the Joker crashes the party and then he throws Rachel out the window and then Batman jumps out the window to rescue her. And it's like, well, why don't you go back up there to go stop the Joker? Because apparently he's still up there. But I'm so invested in the narrative and the characters in this movie that, you know, little moments like that go over my head. I don't care because I'm too invested in the story. Whereas in this, it just continuously happens to the point of where it just really annoys me, you know, to where it takes me out of the movie. There's another moment in here, the motorcycle chase, which is nowhere near as good as the motorcycle chase in Rogue Nation. Okay, the motorcycle chase in Rogue Nation was just brutal. But in this, it's just him on a motorcycle, and that's it. It's got some cool music, and that's it. And the conclusion to it is lazy, where he's driving his motorcycle, he's trying to elude the police, and he knows where he's going, because Luther and Benji know where to pick him up. So apparently they had this planned out. As it's being executed on screen, as an audience member, I don't know what's going on. But as a character in the movie, Ethan and Benji, Luther and Walker, they all know what the plan is, right? So apparently they had an extraction point to meet up in case something went wrong, because he says, I need extraction. But the movie tries to cheat suspense out of me when you see Hunt drive into this roundabout area and he sits there looking concerned, like, oh, I'm trapped, I don't know how to get out of here, when clearly he knows where he's going. So it's not meant for like him to be afraid of the police. It's meant to confuse the audience. And I hate that kind of crap in movie where it purposely tries to confuse me when they knows damn well that the character in the movie knows what they're doing. They're just doing this so the audience can stay confused. Because all he does is when he drives into that roundabout and the camera spins around him, he just goes to the right of where he came in at. So he clearly knows where he's going, but if for some reason he drives into this roundabout and he sits there just to build suspense with the audience. So I hate, it's a cheat moment, man. It's a cheat. It's a cheat, man. It's a cheat. He doesn't need to, he could have just drove into that roundabout and made a sharp right turn. He didn't have to sit there. But he runs into a car and then he falls into this manhole, or he just cuts this thing open and falls into this hole. And it's like, that's when the cops stop chasing him. And it's just like, you would think they know where that goes, where that leads to. So then they would call backup or something, you know? So it's just very, it's very baffling to me. It's like, I don't know why they decided to do that. And it's just a minor thing, but it just continuously happens throughout the entire movie to the point of where it just sucks me out of the narrative, where I'm rolling my eyes at this point. I'm like, there's so many mistakes in here that stretch the plot of this movie so thin to the point of where I'm just like, I don't care anymore. I just don't, it looks good, but I just don't care about this, you know? So I'm not invested in the story. I'm just seeing all these mistakes, you know? And that's not supposed to happen until you watch the movie like 1500 times. When you watched it the first time, you shouldn't notice these things. You should be so invested in the story that it distracts you from the plot holes and the mistakes. But when I first saw this movie, it's clear as day, because it continuously happens to where it sucks me out of the movie, you know? And that's why Mission Impossible Fallout was disappointing to me. But it's also a good movie because it does have some good technical aspects. The story does keep you on your toes and all that stuff. But I don't like, I feel disappointed with this movie because of those little mistakes that continuously happen throughout the entire narrative. Well, that is my list of disappointing movies of 2018. I hope you enjoyed the video. And as always, thank you for watching, and I will talk to you next time.